Well, good morning, everyone. I want to welcome everyone to Gospel of Grace Community Church. It's wonderful to have you here. I see we've had a few guests this morning. I want to give a special welcome to you. And if this is your first time here, we do have some welcome packets back on the back table. Please grab one of those. There's some information in it about our church, what we believe, what we teach. I think it will give you a lot of good insight into the gospel that we preach here. So that was the first thing. Our call to worship is going to be from Psalm chapter 5. So while you're turning to there, I will go ahead and give you a few more announcements. Did want to say that this is going to be the last call for the lost and found basket back there. There's a couple of items in there. If they are yours, be sure that you grab those, because if you're looking for them next week, they're probably not going to be here. So grab those while you can. Did want to announce that the Women's Bible Study Guide is also back on the table. So if you would, grab one of those if you're going to be attending that. And on the children's ministry, Andre asked me to announce that yesterday we had a very productive children's ministry training workshop where we went over the children's ministry philosophy and the practical details. During the course of our discussion, we realized we needed a few more volunteers. We need someone to help check in the children as they arrive, and each age group's leader will check them out at the end, so we just need help at the beginning and not at the end. This might ideally be a parent willing to come a few minutes earlier to the meeting and to meet and check in the children and to stay a few minutes after the start to welcome any latecomers. We also would love to have one more teenage volunteer to join us, as well as anyone interested in filling in as a substitute on occasion. So that's the children's ministry that we're trying to get started up. And then we did want to ask for prayer. Heather Spencer's friend, Jesse, I believe she had asked for prayer, maybe a Bible study, for her husband, Billy. We ask now that you would pray for Jesse and her family because her husband Billy has passed away. So they had four children, teens to young adults, and you know, just please be praying for peace and comfort for Jesse and for her family as they deal with this loss. Also wanted to mention that this coming Friday night at 7 o'clock, we're going to have Bible study over at the Verona Community Center, so not here, but on the other side of Quicks Mill is where we're going to have that. So 7 o'clock on Friday night, and then the youth study is going to be Wednesday night at 6 o'clock, and it's going to be at Dmitry's house, and that's 400 Enterprise Road. If anyone hasn't been there, so those are all the announcements that I had. So as I mentioned before, our call to worship is from Psalm chapter 5. So if you are willing and able, please stand with me for the reading of God's word. Give ear to my words, O Lord. Consider my groaning. Heed the sound of my cry for help, my King and my God. For to you I pray. In the morning, O Lord, you will hear my voice. In the morning I will order my prayer to you and eagerly watch. For you are not a God who takes pleasure in wickedness. No evil dwells with you. The boastful shall not stand before your eyes. You hate all who do iniquity. You destroy those who speak falsehood. The Lord abhors the man of bloodshed and deceit. But as for me, by your abundant loving kindness, I will enter your house. At your holy temple, I will bow in reverence to you. O Lord, lead me in your righteousness because of my foes. Make your way straight before me. There is nothing reliable in what they say. Their inward part is destruction itself. Their throat is an open grave. They flatter with their tongue. Hold them guilty, O God. By their own devices let them fall. In the multitude of their transgressions, thrust them out. For they are rebellious against you. Let all who take refuge in you be glad. Let them ever sing for joy, and may you shelter them. that those who love your name may exult in you. For it is you who blesses the righteous man, O Lord. You surround him with favor as with a shield. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you and we praise your holy name because you are our King, you are our Lord, and you are our God. You created all things, and you sustain them through your holy will. Father, we praise you because even though you're holy God, you hear our prayers. So we pray today, Father, for protection from the wicked, just like David did here in the psalm we just read. Father, you know the times in which we live. You know the sin that's not just tolerated, but it's celebrated. Abortion, homosexuality. And Father, if you don't stand up and celebrate that, then you're persecuted, even threatened with violence. Father, we're surrounded on all sides by evildoers. But Father, we know that if you're for us, then none can prevail against us. You are our shield, you're our fortress, you're our rock, you're our protection. And Father, we pray that you would expose evil for what it is, that you would convict men of their sin, and that you would turn their hearts to repentance. We especially pray for our leaders, Lord. We pray for our president. We pray for our Supreme Court, that they would put their trust in you rather than in their own pride. Father, we know your victory over sin, it's already been accomplished. It's already won. So, Father, help us to wait patiently for your will to be accomplished. Help us to be workers who are diligent, and Father, to be strong in our faith, to work as Dmitry's preached over the last few weeks, to work and not be idle, to use our talents for you. Now, Father, as we prepare to worship you and in song, to worship you in the preaching of your word, Father, we ask that you would bless our efforts at our ministries, Father, with the children's ministry, with the youth ministry. Father, we ask that you would help us to be kind and loving to visitors. Father, we ask that you would give comfort to this young lady, Jessie, and her family as they grieve the loss of her husband. Father, build them up with that peace that can only come from you. Help Adam and Heather to be strong support for them, Lord, to have the right words to say. Father, we ask that you would bless the musicians, that you would bless the singers today. Father, we ask that you would bless Dmitry as he brings the word. Father, prepare our hearts for worship. Open them to receive your word. And Father, help us to be attentive and diligent to listen, but not just to be hearers, Lord, to be doers also. And Father, we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Down their golden crowns. How precious sing God's praise. And when we first begun.
If you're able, please remain standing for our scripture reading. We're continuing to read through the New Testament, and today our text is found in Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7. After this, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds of the earth, so that no wind would blow on the earth or on the sea or on any tree. And I saw another angel ascending from the rising of the sun, having the seal of the living God. And he cried out with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was granted to harm the earth and the sea, saying, "Do not harm the earth or the sea or the trees until we have sealed the bondservants of our God on their foreheads." And I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000, sealed from every tribe of the sons of Israel. From the tribe of Judah, 12,000 were sealed. From the tribe of Reuben, 12,000. From the tribe of Gad, 12,000. From the tribe of Asher, 12,000. From the tribe of Naphtali, 12,000. From the tribe of Manasseh, 12,000. From the tribe of Simeon, 12,000. From the tribe of Levi, 12,000. From the tribe of Issachar, 12,000. From the tribe of Zebulun, 12,000. From the tribe of Joseph, 12,000. From the tribe of Benjamin, 12,000 were sealed. After these things, I looked, and behold, a great multitude, which no one could count, from every nation, and all tribes and people and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, and palm branches were in their hands. And they cry out with a loud voice, saying, "Salvation to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders answered, saying to me, "These who are clothed in the white robes, who are they? And where have they come from?" I said to him, "My Lord, you know." And he said to me, "These are the ones who come out of the great tribulation, and they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God, and they serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will spread his tabernacle over them. They will hunger no longer, nor thirst any more, nor will the sun beat down on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb in the center of the throne will be their shepherd and will guide them to springs of the water of life. And God will wipe every tear from their eyes." Let's pray. Father, we are grateful to stand before you, getting a glimpse of what will take place in eternity in your presence, and to see your holiness and majesty and greatness and power, and how all the living beings will fall before you and worship you. And we have this privilege right now to be with your people and to honor you, to praise you, to worship you, to acknowledge your goodness, your sovereignty, and your love towards us. We thank you that you have saved us with your amazing grace. Indeed, how sweet the sound. You called us out of darkness, changed our hearts from loving self and pleasing self to now loving you and seeking to please you. It is a supernatural work that no man can explain. It has to be experienced. And Lord, we are grateful that you have sealed us with your Holy Spirit, that we not only trust and believe in the Lord Jesus as our Lord and Savior, but that the Holy Spirit, that you draw us to repentance when we sin. You cause us to pursue holiness. Thank you, Father, for your abundant grace and love towards us. Father, may we live our lives with the foresight of what awaits us in the future. Apostle John had this great privilege of seeing a glimpse of this eternal bliss where there will be no more suffering, no more labor in heat and scorching sun and pain, no more death, no more tears. Lord, may we see that today, and may this cause us to love and live for your glory and honor. We do, Lord, confess our sins, acknowledge that we often don't do what you call us to do, and instead we do what we are not supposed to do. Forgive us when we succumb to the temptations of the flesh. Forgive us when we do not live in our new nature. Lord, cause us to be faithful. I ask you, Lord, to please empower us to have self-control, to be patient, to be long-suffering, to have joy of knowing the truth, and to have love. Love you and to love your people, and to love even those who are perishing. Father, may our love cause us to fulfill your will. Lord, I ask that you would also touch the hearts of those who are not born again, those who are living in rebellion. There are some here today who believe that they know everything that needs to be known and that their main concern in life is to better themselves and to build their kingdom here on earth. That might include a family, career, possessions, status. Lord, may you touch their hearts and may they see themselves as sinners who are living outside your will. And may they see that the wages of sin is death, eternal damnation. Lord, draw them to Christ Jesus. May they see his love for them. May they repent, submit their life to Jesus as Lord. Father, we ask that you would also bless the preaching of your word. This is your word. Lord, we are your people. We ask that you would speak to us, to our hearts. Use me as a vessel. Enable me to speak clearly, to be coherent, to communicate things well, to not forget anything that needs to be said. And Lord, also if something is of my own that I would not say it, and Lord, I pray that you would just use me as a vessel to accomplish your purpose. And Lord, may we go out of the service today different than when we came in. May we have greater love towards you and towards your people. We pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. Please take your seats.
As the children's choir prepares to sing the song, the song is titled, "Oh, Be Careful, Little Eyes, What You See." And I'd like us to call us to be reminded about the application of these words to our lives. Even those who are more mature and maybe no longer consider themselves as children, we have an opportunity to think about how we can be careful, how we act, what we think, and what we do. Every verse of this song has a phrase that the Father is looking down in love. You know, as God's children, where God is our Father, we are no longer under the wrath of God that the righteous God has every right to be wrathful at the sinful things that we do as enemies when we were enemies of God. That is no longer the case. We heard about the amazing grace, the mercy and the love of God that has called us and those who were his to be saved, to be his children. But as God's children, one way that he expresses his love for his children is through discipline when we err. In Hebrews 12:6, it says, "For the Lord disciplines the one he loves, and chastises every son whom he receives." You know, if we compare our hands and eyes to those of the children, they're not much bigger than theirs. So that this is really a reminder for all of us to be careful, to honor the Lord in everything that we do, we think, and we say. And of course, one of the great benefits of having a Heavenly Father is we can always reach out to him to help. And God has promised us that we will receive what we ask for if we ask it in his name and according to his will. So as we ask him to help us, guard our eyes, to be careful what we do, what we think. As Pastor Dmitry mentioned in his prayer, he will give us the desire to do the right thing, and he will give us a repulsion for sin and a desire to go towards that which is good, instead of doing what we used to do, the old sinful habits.
Say, for the Father up above.
Gathered together to hear of God's love, to devote ourselves to Him. And the Lord grants us this privilege because He loves us. He chose us for salvation. He pours out His grace on us. And our desire and privilege is to praise Him for His love. May we worship Him with our obedience to His will. Please open your Bibles to John chapter 13. John chapter 13, and our text today will be verses 34 and 35, just two verses. And for the next several weeks, I'd like for us to look at a specific passages. I want to do some selective messages from different texts that will address practical things that we Christians need to have clarity on. Today, we look at Jesus' command to love one another. Next Sunday, Lord willing, is Father's Day, and we will look at what it means that God is our Heavenly Father and how we, as earthly fathers, are to be pleasing to the Lord, fulfilling our duty and obligation. Then, later on, Lord willing, we will begin our next sequential exposition of a new book. But what is love? What is love, and why are Christians to be known for their love? You know, I think the world has their own little definition. The world interprets love as a warm, emotional feeling which brings pleasure and bliss, and which in turn it causes this favorable disposition or favorable treatment to someone else, someone who you love. And there's a worldly philosophy which states you should love the person who loves you. And I think it's easy to love a person who loves you and not to care for those who act unfriendly towards you. I think that's natural. But as those who are redeemed by Christ, you're not to adhere to the world's standards, to the world's definition of love. Instead, what we need to do is we need to obey God's mandate to love. We need to know what God means when He says, love one another, and then we need to obey Him. Before we read our passage, let me set the context for us. In John's Gospel, chapter 13 begins with Jesus and His disciples, the day before Passover, this would be Thursday evening, gathering in Jerusalem. And they gather in the upper room to have supper. This will end up the last supper that Jesus has with his disciples before his death, burial, and resurrection. We will see that Judas, he will betray Jesus. And then the religious leaders of Israel, they will judge and condemn Jesus to death. And then Jesus will be killed by the Roman soldiers. But during this Last Supper, Jesus, he takes the role of a servant. In chapter 13, it says that he washes the feet of all of his disciples. And then he foretells them that one of them will betray him. The Jewish religious leaders were looking to kill Jesus. They were annoyed by his teaching. They were jealous that people were following him. So they wanted to get rid of him. They were looking for Jesus. And Jesus says, one of you will betray me. The disciples, they then began to look at each other. They wanted to see if they could get the sense of who this would be. When the disciple John asked Jesus, who is it, Lord? Our text says that Jesus, he took the morsel, he dipped it, and he gave it to Judas Iscariot. And then Jesus tells Judas, what you do, do quickly. So Judas immediately leaves the room. He goes to betray Jesus. And when Jesus is left with his 11 faithful disciples, he then says the following words. Let's go ahead and now read our text. John chapter 13, verse 34 and 35. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. So before Jesus endures the punishment for sinners whom he came to save, he gives them a mandate, a command, an order to love one another. He says, a new commandment I give to you. Now, in the Old Testament, the Lord Yahweh, he gave orders to his people. He gave guidelines concerning what they're to do and what they're not to do. So God's people already had the five books of Moses, which were known as the Torah or the Pentateuch, which contained God's law. When Jesus was teaching, the Pharisees often tried to challenge Jesus. At one time, one of them, a lawyer, he asked Jesus, teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? And Jesus, in Matthew chapter 22, verses 37 through 40, answered, and he said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and foremost commandment. The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend the whole law and the prophets. Notice that the whole law is built on two main commandments: to love God and love your neighbor as yourself. In the Ten Commandments, God emphasized that he is to be loved above everything else. In Exodus chapter 20, verse 3, God said, you shall have no other gods before me. In Exodus chapter 20, verse 4 and 5, God said, you shall not make for yourself an idol or any likeness of what is in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the water under the earth. You shall not worship them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. In Exodus chapter 20, verse 7, God said, you shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not leave him unpunished who takes his name in vain. God commanded people to love him. Well, in addition to loving God, he also taught Israelites to love their countrymen, their fellow countrymen. So in Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18, God commanded, you shall not take vengeance nor bear any grudge against the sons of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. So love God, love your neighbor as yourself. If God had already commanded the Israelites to love God and their neighbors, then why does Jesus, in John chapter 13, verse 34, why does he say that he's giving them a new commandment? How was it new? It was new in the sense that he mandates them to love one another as he had loved them. There's the distinction. Love as I have loved you. That's what Jesus is telling his disciples. You see, the Old Testament command emphasized that the Hebrews, that the Jewish people, were to love their fellow countrymen, to not bear a grudge against them. Jesus' mandate to love others is new because it points to loving others as he had loved us and gave himself up for us. Now think about this. Jesus is the Lord of all creation. Colossians chapter 1 says that he created everything for himself and he sustains everything for his own glory, for his own purpose. He's the Lord of creation. And yet, he just washed his disciples' feet. He acted as though he was their slave. He willingly came to this earth to sacrifice his life for our salvation so that we could have peace with God the Father. And now he expects us to love others with that same kind of love. That was also new because it wasn't limited to only loving those who belong to our own nation, to our own country. Instead, we're to now love everyone. The fact that Jesus gives this commandment, this divine commandment, it proves that he is God. Only God can order people to do specific things for his glory. And God says, Jesus says, I give you this new commandment. He is God. Now, why did they need to be told to love one another? Why? Because they thought they had reasons not to love one another. Think about this. All of them were different in their work, in their education, in their interests. All of them were different, just like all of us are different. Matthew chapter 4, verses 18 through 22 shows us how Jesus called his first four disciples. Notice what happened there. It says, now as Jesus was walking by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Immediately they left their nets, and they followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets, and he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. So notice, Jesus chooses two sets of brothers who had their own fishing businesses. Peter and Andrew, they had their own boat. They had their own, quote-unquote, employees, their own people who helped them to fish, trying to make a living by catching fish. And a short distance from them, on that same shoreline, Jesus calls James and John, who were the sons of Zebedee, and Zebedee also had a fishing business. Peter and Andrew, they knew of James and John and their father Zebedee. And even though they fished in the same area, listen, they weren't part of the same company. They weren't the same business. Two different enterprises. And we could fairly say that there was always competition and strategy between them. Each business, each boat, each company wanted the best spot in the lake to catch the most fish. If one pair of brothers had success, the other pair would envy them, try to outperform them. Also, our text, scripture also tells us that Nathaniel, Thomas, and Philip, they also worked as fishermen. when they were together after Christ's death and resurrection, it says that they were all fishing. So it's possible that they were all fishermen there. But just take note of this, that Peter and Andrew, they had reasons not to like James and John. Well, who else was at the Sea of Galilee? Mark chapter 2, verse 13 and 14 says that as Jesus went out again by the seashore, all the people were coming to him and he was teaching them. And as he passed by, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting in the tax booth. And he said to him, "Follow me." And he got up and followed him. So this Levi is actually our gospel writer, Matthew. Matthew was a Jewish man who was working as a tax collector. He was taking money from fellow Jews to then give that money to the oppressing Roman government, Roman Empire. And tax collectors who were working for Caesar, they were despised in Israel. What was Matthew doing at the shore of Sea of Galilee? You know what he was doing? He was waiting for Zebedee's boat and Peter's boat to come to shore so he could then see how many fish they caught and then charge them an appropriate tax. The disciples wondered, why did Jesus choose Matthew? Why did he choose this man who betrayed his own nation, who was working for the enemy? An enemy who was occupying their land. Why would Jesus choose Matthew? You know, immediately after Jesus calls him, he goes actually to Matthew's house. In the Gospel of Mark, it says that as Jesus is there in Matthew's home with other tax collectors and sinners, the disciples are outside and the Pharisees are rebuking Jesus and saying to the disciples, "Why is your teacher dining with sinners?" I thought it was interesting that his disciples were not with Jesus and Matthew inside the house at some point. So they had reasons to not like Matthew. Also, in Luke chapter 6, verse 15, we read that among Jesus' disciples, there was also this man named Simon who was a zealot. Simon the zealot. The Jewish zealots, they engaged in politics, they engaged in anarchy, attempting to overthrow the Roman government. Needless to say, Simon had a very strong opinion about Matthew, and some of the other disciples had a very strong opinion of Simon the zealot. Now, they've been called to walk with Jesus, and they walked with him for 3 years. And perhaps while they were with Jesus, perhaps they may not have openly hated each other. They might have pressed down their disagreements. But now Jesus was going to physically leave them. He was going to return to heaven. Therefore, he gives his followers this mandate, this order, love one another. Love one another. Did the disciples argue? Can we be sure that there was contention between them? Actually, yes, we can. Scripture gives us that information. In Luke chapter 9, verse 46, it tells us how still early in Jesus' ministry there, the disciples, they began to argue with each other about who's greater. Who's greater? I think it's easy to be annoyed by someone who's proud, who's boastful, who thinks too much of themselves. It's easy to be annoyed by that kind of person. Now, if someone claims to be greater, you know what he means? He means that he's either richer, stronger, or smarter at something. And it's natural to become defensive when all of a sudden you get attacked or when you are undermined or questioned with your abilities and knowledge. So they had arguments. Who's greater? Well, that was in the beginning of the ministry. However, in Luke chapter 22, verse 24, right before Jesus' sacrifice on Golgotha. I mean, right before his atonement. We read there that, and there arose also a dispute among them, talking about the disciples, as to which one of them was regarded to be greatest. And so here we see that the disciples argued all the way till the end about who would sit higher in Jesus' kingdom. You know what they needed? They needed to have this unconditional love towards one another. And Jesus teaches them that. Little does Peter know that he will soon deny Jesus three times, that he will provide a reason for the rest of the disciples to turn against him. But in John chapter 13, verse 34, the text that we're looking at today, what we see is Jesus shattering, destroying all reasons for us to not love each other. And he says, love one another. The reasons that you think are valid, are legitimate, move them aside. Destroy them. Love one another. As believers, we must love each other unconditionally. And so I would like to first turn to you, husband and wife. Do you love each other? Are you harboring any bitterness or perhaps maybe distaste towards one another? Is there any unforgiveness between you two? Does each one of you genuinely care for each other? Husband, do you think that you have a legitimate reason to not love your wife? Then just as Christ shattered the disciples' reasons to not love other disciples, today Christ is shattering your reasons to not love your wife. He's shattering every one of your reasons. In Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, Paul writes, husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church. Those who became the church, they used to be rebellious sinners. We didn't deserve Christ's love. Instead, we deserved his wrath. But Christ loved his unlovable church. And so we husbands are to also love our wives unconditionally. Wife, what about you? Do you think you have a legitimate reason to not love your husband? Well, Jesus does not accept your reason or excuses. He says, love one another. Now, how are you to love your husband? Ephesians chapter 5, verse 33 states, the wife must see to it that she respects her husband. Examine your own heart. Do you truly respect your husband? Do you show him respect? Now, perhaps there's unforgiveness in the family. If there's unforgiveness in the family, then look what Colossians chapter 3, verse 12 through 14 says. We read there, so as those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness and patience, bearing with one another and forgiving each other. Whoever has a complaint against anyone, just as the Lord forgave you, so also should you, beyond all these things, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity. Beloved, if Christ mandates for us to love one another, oh, then this especially applies to us who made our vows before God and before other people. It's absurd to hear a professing Christian say that they somehow lost their love towards their spouse. Well, now I want to turn to you parents. Do you truly love your children? You know, Proverbs chapter 13, verse 24 says, He who withholds his rod hates his son. But he who loves him disciplines him diligently. So if your child is not disciplined, then what does that say about you and your love for your child? Furthermore, parents are commanded in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Now, to provoke your child to anger is to agitate them. Agitate them with your behavior. When you teach them one thing and then you do something completely the opposite, you are agitating your child. That's the opposite of showing them love. When you're unreasonable with your strength or with your force in disciplining them, you are agitating. You're provoking them to anger. When you're too lazy to understand what's really going on in their lives, it is then that you are provoking them to anger. When you have favorites in the family and you treat some of your children better than others, you're provoking them to anger. To love our children, it is to treat them as a gift from God, to truly care for them. Well, what about you, child? How are you to show love to your parents? You know, regardless if you're 8 or 18, you need to ask yourself this question. Do you truly love your parents? Do you truly love your parents? You know, in Exodus chapter 20, verse 12, God commanded the children, honor your father and your mother that your days may be prolonged in the land which the Lord your God gives you. And so, do you honor them? Or do you speak bad about them to your friends? What kind of attitude do you have when they ask you to do something? Colossians chapter 3, verse 20 says, children, be obedient to your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing to the Lord. You're to please the Lord by honoring and obeying your parents. Well, what if you're not married? What if you don't have children? And what if you're no longer living under your parents' roof? Listen, the Lord's mandate to love one another, it still applies to you too. We all must love our brothers and sisters. We all must love our fellow church members. We must love our neighbors. We must love our co-workers. We must love the rest of the people whom we interact with. Well, what if you know someone who hates you, who actively hates you? What are you to do then? Jesus in Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 through 46 said, you have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you so that you may be the sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? Jesus leaves no excuse or reason for any of us to not love others. Micah chapter 6 verse 8 instructs us, he has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? But to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. None of us deserve God's grace and love, but he has granted it to us. And now we are required to grant our love to others. 1 John chapter 4, verse 19 says, we love because he first loved us. If you're a believer, then your identity should be love. People should know you by your love. But what kind of love are we talking about here? How are we to love others? Are we merely talking about, you know, these pleasant feelings, these emotional, warm sensations towards others, or perhaps maybe not speaking bad about others? Well, look at our text again. In John chapter 13, verse 34, we see Jesus qualify what kind of love we're to have. He's qualifying the required love as, even as I have loved you. The quality of love needs to match what Christ had demonstrated. Christ's love, it is different from the world's idea of love. The world measures love by personal feelings towards someone else. Listen, it's inward focused, and it's always affected by outside circumstances. So, if the person pleases me because they are attractive, they're smart, they're funny, they're talented, or they're rich, well then, I will love them. That's how the world perceives love. Christ's love, it is measured by the willingness to sacrifice. Christ's love is measured by the willingness to sacrifice. It's more than just a feeling towards someone else. It is outward focused, and yet it is not affected by outside circumstances. Romans chapter 5, verse 8 tells us that God demonstrates his own love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Earlier we mentioned already a couple times how Jesus, knowing that he's about to be betrayed by one of his disciples, and how that will lead him to get tortured and then eventually killed, he gets a basin, gets a towel, and he washes his disciples' dirty feet. Remember, the roads were not paved. They didn't have shoes the way we have shoes today. They had sandals, and so a man's feet would get dirty. And Jesus shows his love by washing his disciples' dirty feet. And that shows us that true love is sacrificial. It doesn't seek what's best for myself. Instead, it seeks what's best for others. Later on in John chapter 15, verse 12 and 13, Jesus will again say, "This is my commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that one lay down his life for his friends." Jesus proved his sacrificial love towards us. He proved it by giving his life up as a ransom for many. His love, it serves as an example, serves as a model, and a standard of how we are to love. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1 and 2 reminds us, "Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children and walk in love, just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma." If we're to love others with the same kind of love that Christ loved us, then let's talk a bit about sacrificing. Husband, how are we to love our wife sacrificially? How does that practically look like? Ephesians chapter 5, verses 25 through 28 says, "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church," and listen, "and gave himself up for her, so that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, that he might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she would be holy and blameless. So husbands ought also to love their own wives as their own bodies." Sacrificial love, it demands giving up personal desires, giving up the desire for pleasure and comfort for the sake of pleasing your wife. Practically speaking, it means you could at least go with her to the places that she wants to go. You could do with her the things that she would like to do. But for some of us, that means helping her around the house, preparing her an occasional breakfast, or maybe just spending some valuable time with her. to love sacrificially, it means that you hear your wife's opinions. It means that you consider how your decisions impact her. We're to love sacrificially. Well, what about you, wife? How are you to love sacrificially? Well, you too are required to sacrifice your preferences and desires for the sake of honoring your husband. You're to sacrificially serve him. You're to support him privately and publicly. Affirm to him that he is your head and that you want to honor the Lord by being submissive to him. Parents, how are we to show our children this sacrificial love? Well, we're to be willing to spend valuable time with them, training them in the instruction and discipline of the Lord. Even when they reject our instructions, we're to continue to invest in them, to spend time doing the things that they like to do, letting them know how much we truly love and how much we truly care for them. What about you, child? How are you to love your parents sacrificially? You too must differ in your preferences. Instead, obey what your parents tell you. You're to honor your parents and be thankful for all that they do for you. Well, what about us members of the local church? Can we show our sacrificial love towards one another? Absolutely. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24 and 25, it says, "Let us consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds, not forsaking our own assembling together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near." Surely, you have other things to do during Friday night Bible study. You have other obligations and things to do during ministry opportunities and ministry obligations, during worship service. But love demands your sacrifice. And so we sacrifice our time, our prosperity, and our pleasure so that we can go and encourage our fellow brothers and sisters in the church. It will cost you to be Christ's disciple. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 14, verse 33, Jesus said, "So then, none of you can be my disciple who does not give up all his own possessions." In our text today, we see Jesus teaching us to love one another with sacrificial love, which he loved us with the same kind of love. Well, let's look now at John chapter 13, verse 35. We read, "By this all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." Christ loved us with this unconditional, this sacrificial love. And as a response, we are now obligated to also love him. We're to love him back. Now, how does Christ expect us to show our love for him? The answer is in John chapter 14, verse 15. Jesus says, "If you love me, you will do what? Keep my commandments." If you love me, he said, you will keep my commandments. So our obedience to Christ's word, it proves our love for him. A Christian who faithfully walks after Christ, he proves that their life has been changed, that they have been born again through this supernatural process of regeneration. An unbeliever, he lives as though he's the Lord of his own life, does whatever he wants. A born-again believer now submits his life to the Lordship of Christ. In addition, according to John chapter 13, verse 35, we see that when we submit to the Lord and when we sacrificially love one another, we prove to others that we are Christians, that we are indeed believers. And unbelievers, they notice and they are amazed seeing how we Christians in the church love each other and how we are willing to give up our lives for one another. They're amazed to see such love. The disciples of Christ, they're known by their love. Apostle John, in his old age, he repeated this truth often in his epistle. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 9 through 11, he says, "The one who says he's in the light and yet hates his brother is in the darkness until now. The one who loves his brother abides in the light, and there is no cause for stumbling in him. But the one who hates his brother is in the darkness and walks in darkness and does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes." And also 1 John chapter 4, verse 8, he says, "The one who does not love does not know God, for God is love." Well, what if you, examining your own heart, and you see that you truly do not have love towards others? What if this is about you? Well, perhaps this is evidence that you are not yet born of God, that you've never lived through the supernatural process of regeneration. 1 John chapter 3, verse 10, it says, "By this the children of God and the children of the devil are obvious. Anyone who does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor the one who does not love his brother." 1 John chapter 4, verse 20 and 21 makes it crystal clear. "If someone says, 'I love God,' and hates his brother, he is a liar. For the one who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. And this commandment we have from him, that the one who loves God should love his brother also." And so if today you are convicted of your sin because you are not loving others as God has commanded you to love them, then you too must repent. Repent of your sin. Submit to Jesus as Lord. If you don't repent, you will bear the consequences of your sin. See, Christ came to give life. He came to give life with abundance. And so turn to him. Ask him for forgiveness. Ask him for his grace, and then trust his sacrifice for you. Only Christ can grant you this supernatural love. This week I read a story of Princess Alice of the United Kingdom. She was born in 1843, and then she was married in 1862 to Ludwig IV, the Grand Duke of Hesse. And together they had seven children. In 1878, when Princess Alice was 35 years old, her youngest, her four-year-old daughter Marie, got seriously ill with this highly contagious disease called diphtheria. And the doctors, they told the princess to make sure that she stays away from her little daughter and that she does not breathe the air that her daughter was breathing. They warned her about it. But when Marie was dying, struggling to breathe, the mother, Princess Alice, forgetting all about herself, just completely disregarding any danger, she took her little baby into her arms to keep her from choking. And as Marie was rasping and struggling to breathe, she was clinging to her little life. The child turned to her mother and said, "Mama, kiss me." And without even thinking about the consequences, Alice tenderly kissed her little daughter. On November 16th, four-year-old Marie died. And a few days later, Princess Alice began to show symptoms of the disease. And within a month, she too passed away. Real love forgets self. Real love is willing to pay the cost. Dear church, we are exhorted today to continue to love one another with the same sacrificial love that Christ has showed us. I want to see our church have strong marriages. I want to see our church have God-honoring families and actively minister in our congregation. We're called to impact our community. But how can we if we do not have love? In Mark chapter 9, verse 50, we read, Jesus there says, salt is good, but if the salt becomes unsalty, with what will you make it salty again? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. Beloved, may we all understand God's mandate to love, and may we pursue obedience to the Lord's instructions. If you're willing and able, could you please rise for prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for reminding us today of your charge to us. You have shown us your love by sending our Lord Jesus to this earth to redeem us. And our Lord Jesus, you proved your love by giving up your life as a ransom for many. Thank you for that example, for that model. May we be faithful to love one another as you have called us to do. We pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Let us love and sing and wonder. Let us praise our Savior's name. He has washed the loss of wonder. He has swept down silence's grave. He has washed us with his blood. He has brought us nigh.
Me to close the service with prayer, so please bow with me. Heavenly Father, your great love is incomprehensible, and we ask that you would stir up our love for others, our love for you, that our minds would turn to the great love that you have shown us, and that would drive us to demonstrate love for those in our own homes and our neighbors and our church members, that we would demonstrate your love to all those that come in contact with us, and that we would be known by our love, and that would be a reflection of you, and that you would be glorified. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.